Hello, it's my honor to present to you today for the NIH's Conference on Inclusion Across the Lifespan. I will be speaking to you today on the inclusion of older adults in clinical research, including both observational and clinical trials. My name is Cynthia Boyd, and I'm a geriatrician and a primary care physician and a clinical investigator at Johns Hopkins University. Our charge today was to discuss lessons learned regarding the inclusion of populations across the lifespan in clinical studies, with evidence-based practical advice for the scientific community. And our focus is on pediatric and older populations, as well as consideration of special populations across the life course. My remarks are going to focus on older populations, but with the recognition that most of these special populations are very much present as we age and in our older population. So in terms of the evidence base, a fundamental question is whether participants in a trial are representative of the actual population who are living with the condition or conditions under study. We know from a lot of research that the population who has a condition under study is often older and often has multiple chronic conditions when compared to the populations who get into trial. Over the past decade, the number of trials with explicit age exclusions has gone down, and this has led to increased enrollment in trials of older adults. But older adults are still represented at levels well below that which their older patients are actually affected. Over a similar period of time, the number of trials that exclude people with specific comorbidities or coexisting conditions may go up, with an example being heart failure trials. And what this may lead to is that we still may have a population in a trial that is not representative of people living with the condition under study. So in this example about heart failure, most of the studies ended up excluding people with chronic kidney disease, which is a very common comorbidity of heart failure and would decrease the generalizability to the population who actually lives with heart failure. So we obviously need to get the exclusion and inclusion criteria for trials and clinical studies right, but it is also really important to think about who actually ends up included or enrolled, as who is the average patient in a trial may tell us a lot about who the results are most generalizable to. This study by Conrad et al. Shows that when looking at these four commonly prescribed drugs, the proportion of older patients in the trial reports was far below the proportion of older patients in the population that actually ends up treated with the condition. And so the ends that you see here are number of studies showing that this is a common scenario. In this work done with several of my colleagues, we actually looked at the body of literature. We looked at clinical trials to support treatment for diabetes that made it into Cochrane reviews, which are compilations of all the evidence available for a specific clinical question. And we looked at all the studies that made it into those systematic reviews for diabetes treatment. And we looked to see what their inclusion and exclusion criteria are. And what you can see here is that more than 40%, for example, of the diabetes studies that made it into these bodies of evidence excluded people who were living with renal insufficiency or chronic kidney disease. Again, suggesting that there may be a mismatch with who actually is able to enroll in studies and that our evidence base may not apply well to people, particularly older people with multiple chronic conditions. In this viewpoint published by Dr. Bernard, Dr. Clayton, and Dr. Lauer about the first NIH policy conference on inclusion across the lifespan, I found this quote particularly salient. Enrolling older patients in clinical trials invariably means patients with more comorbidities will be included in studies, meaning that the data will be noisier. And I think this conference today represents a great opportunity for us to think about how we move forward with implementing what we know needs to happen in ways that allow us to draw meaningful conclusions that are generalizable to the population. I'm going to talk about a study that was published in JAGS in 2019 that highlighted the 5 T's framework. This builds off of the 5 M's framework, which I'll be sharing in a minute. And what this is a framework for communicating with researchers who don't specifically study aging to increase the inclusion of older adults in clinical research. The 5 T's include thinking about the target population, the team, time, tips to accommodate older adults, and the tools that we need. So for target population, the guidance given is to avoid exclusions that limit study generalizability, and fundamentally to understand the prevalence of the studied condition in older adults. And as some examples of the kind of thinking that you might want to do in this step, I'll share this work by Dr. Weiss and his colleagues, which showed that for these major chronic diseases, disease in isolation is actually the exception rather than the rule. With, for example, for coronary heart disease, less than 20% of older women who have coronary heart disease don't have any of these other 4 conditions that are listed here on the slide. And obviously, if you looked at a larger number of conditions, the number of people who only had heart disease would even be smaller. This is another way of thinking about the data. This shows that while this problem is particularly relevant to older populations, which is often referred to as 65 and older, as people age with chronic diseases and develop other coexisting conditions, there can be a very high prevalence of common conditions that may end up affecting whether or not a recommended treatment actually really applies. And so thinking about who really has a condition and what else they have going along with it is really fundamental to designing trials and studies that inform how we care for these patients. Here's just one last example of a way to think about looking at the population to see who we should include. This data shows that among people with osteoporosis, the population with comorbidity is much higher than the population that enrolls in studies. This next part of the 5 T's is to think about the team. And with the recommendations given to engage geriatrician researchers and aging experts and to connect with caregivers and community resources to make sure that when we're thinking about this population, we're thinking about the full breadth of people that are involved in their care and well-being. In terms of tools, it's fundamental that we, in clinical studies, choose appropriate measures of function, physical performance, and patient-reported outcomes, and that we have to balance data collection needs with participant burden for measure collection. When we are designing studies, we need to think about the time needed. We need to anticipate longer study visits for some participants and be prepared to accommodate comorbidities and common impairments during processes and long study visit days. For example, providing food and using things like pocket talkers to help people with hearing impairment understand all the information being shared. It also may take longer to schedule follow-up visits, and we need to be thinking about these things proactively. We want to budget for things like door-to-door transportation and using things like high-contrast print materials and large font size. And we have to plan for a higher attrition rate, which has implications for sample size and power calculations. And I believe all of these things need to be thought about as we're thinking about inclusion and exclusion criteria and the design of the study. Now I'm going to shift and talk a bit about the 5 M's on which the 5 T's, which I just shared with you, were based. This slide is taken from the American Geriatric Society website. The five M's are to be thinking about multi-complexity, which describes the whole person, typically an older adult living with multiple chronic conditions, advanced illness, and with complicated potential biopsychosocial needs. And when we care for this population, we need to be focusing on the four M's. So for mind, we need to be thinking about mentation, dementia, delirium, depression. For mobility, the degree, people's function, their balance, their gait, and how to prevent falls. For medications, thinking about the number of medicines and optimal prescribing and deprescribing, and thinking about what matters most to the patients in front of us. And this means focusing on the individual's own meaningful goals and care preferences. When we think about research, so moving beyond the clinical setting, these same five M's have important implications for how we design studies in order to maximize the inclusion of older adults. So for mind, we need to consider cognition, and this may include simplifying study processes and including caregiver and proxies, and not excluding people with cognitive changes unless it's truly indicated. For mobility, we want to ensure access. We may want to be making home visits available for follow-up. And again, we want to be thinking about how to include the caregiver or proxy respondent. For medications, we need to think about the non-study meds that people are on, and when appropriate, discontinue or deprescribe or reduce the dose of things that may be potentially harmful in older adults. And we need to be prepared for common adverse events, adverse drug events happening in studies that include older populations, and particularly those on a lot of medication. But so we want to plan for it, but not just exclude people, because people being on multiple medications is very common in the older population. And again, we're aiming for our studies to be generalizable to the older population. When we think about what matters most, this again reiterates the importance of making sure we're including outcomes that are important to patients and stakeholders, including family members and among others. For multi-complexity, we really want to fundamentally limit exclusions so that we are being as representative as possible of the population who's actually living with the conditions that you're studying. We need to account for competing risks, and we need to be able to address trade-offs, that achieving the goals for one condition may need to be balanced against achieving the goals for another condition, and that these principles need to underlie how we design clinical studies for that are inclusive of older adults, including those that fall under the special population. I so appreciate your time, and I'm very much looking forward to our rich discussion on the day of the conference and learning from all of you. Thank you.